He should talk to my colleagues.
Mr. Speaker.
Stuart Nash.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. You'll note that I didn't inject in any way, shape or form because I might have to engage in some of the same activity. Mr. Speaker, we are supporting the Friends Society's Credit Unions Regulatory Improvement Amendment bills. Mr. Speaker, the bill isn't quite as boring as that last member made it out to be. In fact, when he said at the very end, I am very pleased to introduce this bill to the House, you wouldn't have believed it, would you? You wouldn't have believed it. And I understand Mr. Tabatow's frustration here, because at least if you're reading something, at least put a little bit of energy into it. And especially when it's the member's bill. You know, it's his only member's bill. So get out there, go hard for the credit union, stand up for what you believe in, a bit of passion. And, you know, read it as if you mean it. But anyway, Mr. Speaker, what I want to say is there is a credit union in Hawke's Bay. It's called NZCU Baywide. It does a fantastic job for members and for people of the Bay. It is a different type of organisation than a bank. And it plays a very important role. And, you know, the legislation that governs NZCU Baywide is 35 years old now. And the world has changed significantly since 1982. I think you're in the House. No, you... Anyway, so the world has changed significantly.
Well, if Member continues that, he won't be.
So I think it is up to Parliament to bring this piece of legislation up to the 21st century standard, because, you know, there is no doubt we are demanding a much higher level of accountability from our financial institutions, but we also want to level the playing field for them as well, so that citizens have true options about whether they go to credit unions, friendly societies, banks or whatever, in terms of borrowing, lending, etc., etc. Mr. Speaker, there is a process point that I would like to bring up before I continue, and that is, and I'm going to quote here, what Stuart Smith in an interview with Fairfax actually said, and I quote, the proposed changes, this is talking about this bill, the proposed changes were originally part of the Regulatory Systems Commercial Matters Amendment Bill. However, the decision was made to put them forward in a standalone bill. End quote. Now, Mr. Speaker, the Regulatory System Commercial Matters Amendment Bill was a government bill that had minimal changes and minimal deletions from select committee or committee as the whole. How or why a minister would actually take that bill, take these clauses or this part of the bill out of the original bill and give it to another member as a private member's bill is highly concerning. There are two things that concern me. First of all, that is so not appropriate in any way, shape or form, and we know this. The second thing is it just shows how serious the government is about this bill itself. Because when a member drafts a private member's bill and it goes into the ballot, the odds of it being drawn out are actually not that high. And the member himself has alluded to this. I'm not too sure how long the member's been in the House for. This is your second term, isn't it, Mr. Smith? First term? Third term? Anyway, he's been in here long enough, and he's the first to admit it is his first bill that's ever been born at first term, first bill that's ever been drawn out of the ballot. So the odds of it being drawn out are not that high. It just shows the level of respect or the level of urgency or you know, where this actually places in the government's work plan. Now that it has been drawn out, you heard the member, it was almost as if, you know, some people get a bill drawn out of the ballot and they're ecstatic because it's something they're very passionate about. I mean, I had a bill drawn out about council amalgamation, and I can talk for an hour on that without notes. But anyway, probably longer, but often it's something that a member is very passionate about, and they take every opportunity to jump up and they use the media and they go hard on it. And then there are other times when a member's bill gets drawn out, and this is the classic case, where you can almost hear them go, oh no, how did that happen? And they get a speech and they've got to read it out, and there's about as much passion as a damp squid. Now, the thing is that I am aware that credit unions and friendly societies do welcome this piece of legislation, but I know that the question a number of people will be asking is, what is a credit union? What is a friendly society? I mean, what are we actually doing with this bill, and who are we actually doing this to, or what sort of organisations are we doing this to? Well, just to help those watching and members on the other side, because I doubt Alistair Scott knows what a credit union is. A credit union, it's a type of financial cooperative. They range in size from small volunteer-only operations through to large entities with thousands of participants. Credit unions can be formed by large corporations, organisations and other entities, and usually for their employees and members. Now, the basic model that a credit union uses is that members pool their money, and technically they're buying shares in the cooperative. That's what they're doing. They're in essence shareholders. But they pool their money in order to be able to provide loans or demand deposit accounts, etc., etc. But I suppose the biggest difference between a bank and a credit union is that a bank functions to generate profits for their shareholders, where a credit union operates as a not-for-profit organisation designed to serve their members, who are also de facto owners. That's the main difference between a credit union and a bank. Now, what's a friendly society? To be honest, I've sat on FEC for a long time. I think I'm reasonably financially literate. And if someone said to me, "What's a friendly society?" You know what? I actually didn't know what a formal definition of a friendly society was. I thought it was the Labour Party, where we all get together because we're all friendly, unlike the National Party. But it's not. There is actually a definition. In a friendly society, and when I talk about this, people will know what I'm talking about, actually. It's sometimes called a mutual society or a benevolent society. And what it is, it's actually a mutual association for the purposes, here we go, of insurance, pensions, savings, or cooperative banking. It is a mutual organisation or a benefit society composed of a body of people who join together for a common financial and social purpose. So it's a little bit like the Labour Party, I suppose. But before modern insurance and the welfare state, friendly societies provided financial and social services to individuals, often in accordance to their religious, political or trade affiliations. What has happened with the advent of the modern bank and the welfare system, for example, is that friendly societies have moved from being, you know, almost like almost like bodies that represent trade unions or et cetera, into a much wider scope. And I suppose that is one of the reasons why we do need to amend the legislation, because the world has changed substantially, and the role of friendly societies and credit unions has also changed. And the thing is, you know, this party will join the government in saying that we support every piece of legislation that looks to get rid of red tape or remove regulatory barriers, unnecessary regulatory barriers. But also we must be aware that in this day and age, the ability to defraud or to launder money, etc., is also heightened. In fact, in front of the Law and Order Select Committee at the moment, there is a bill, the phase two of the anti-money laundering bill. So we also need to be aware that whilst credit unions play a very important part in the fabric of society, often a lot smaller than banks, they also will be covered, and are covered, I'm pretty sure, by anti-money laundering provisions. The thing, I suppose, Mr. Speaker, I'm going to digress slightly here just for about a minute and a half, is the thing that really concerns me is when we look at the police estimates, the amount of money given to police to investigate fraud, and what we heard in our select committee yesterday is, in fact, about 90% of the fraud committed within banks is not taken to the Serious Fraud Office or is not reported, because often these institutions don't want it out there that their employees have committed fraudulent activity. But anyway, back to the bill for another minute and a half. We do support this. We do support this with a passion, and it's necessary. And I look forward to this coming. I'm assuming it's going to come to the Commerce Select Committee. I'm unsure. But I'm assuming it will, which is the reason I'm speaking. And I know the CEO of NZCU Bayside, and he's a very good man, and I'm looking forward to engaging with credit unions and friendly societies, but just understanding the issues that they have and the opportunities they have, but also the opportunities that this bill is going to provide that perhaps aren't available to them at this point in time. But I also want to know what sort of systems they're going to put in place, because this will create extra risks. What this bill will do is ensure that credit unions and friendly societies can actually lend money wider or change their operations. But with any change in operations, certainly ones that are provided through the regulatory and legislative process, there must be systems in place to ensure that with any change, those risks are mitigated. You can never eliminate risk, but they're certainly mitigated. So there will be a cost to credit societies and to credit unions and friendly societies. I'm keen to know what that cost is, and I suspect that might be one of the reasons why there are some credit unions that do oppose this, but it will appear before the Select Committee, and I'm looking forward to following this through to the next days. But we will support this, and it's been a pleasure to speak on it. Thank you much, Mr. Speaker.
Chris Bishop.
Speaker, well, the deep irony of hearing